to a great future in motor retailing. Welcome to a company that's grown from one dealership in the northeast of England to become one of the largest motor retailers in Europe. I look forward to your joining our company, and I hope that you will be with us for the rest of your working life, because we are looking for colleagues who see their long-term futures with us, and we want to be the company where you can fulfill all of your career aspirations. We're here at Houghton House, which is the support centre for all of our dealership operations. We have several meeting rooms, the largest of which is the lecture theatre, which seats 130 people. So this really is an ideal building for our support centre. This building is only a mile from where the company started at Stony Gate. It is now an Aston Martin and Jaguar dealership, but the site has a long history. Let me show you some old photographs and you will see how the business has grown. Then we'll look into some of the reasons why. This is Reg Vardy, my father, who started the business as a haulage contractor in the 1920s. He actually began with a handcart, bought his first horse, and eventually moved into trucks to develop a successful haulage business. After the war in 1945, he bought this site, which at that time had a tin shed and two petrol pumps. My father built up the haulage business and then began to sell cars, and he took on the Ford franchise in 1950. He had three sons, and as each of us left school, we joined the family business. My father died in 1976, leaving a well-established haulage and motor retailing business, great foundations on which to build. In the late 70s, we took on franchises for some of the world's finest motor cars, and through the use of innovative finance schemes, became leading retailers for Aston Martin, Ferrari, and Rolls-Royce. It was with these cars that we first learned how to make cars affordable.
Reg Vardy, making cars affordable.
We were soon able to use the same techniques in the volume market and expanded with Ford, Vauxhall, and Rover in the early 1980s. In 1982, we came to our first crossroads and decided to divide up the businesses. My elder brother took the haulage business, I kept the motor dealership, and my younger brother took the money and emigrated to Australia. New dealerships were added throughout the 80s, and in 1987, we acquired our first businesses outside of the Northeast region, buying BMW in Harrogate and Jaguar and Rover in Aberdeen. In 1989, we came to our second crossroads. We had built the business as a private company. We had 17 dealerships. But we saw that our ambitions to become a national motor group could be achieved much more quickly if we became a public company and had access to funds from a wide range of investors. So we floated the company on the London Stock Exchange, and in October 1989, we became Reg Vardy PLC. We had an appetite for growth, we were successful, and we were very profitable. But what was it that was driving us forward, and how is it that the company has achieved such tremendous growth? If there is one word which characterizes our people, it is passion. A passion to be the best in the industry. A passion to do things better today than we did yesterday. A passion for this year's results to be better than last year's. And a passion for excellence in all that we do. I hope that in this video you will see evidence of this passion and enthusiasm in all of our people.
You have heard how Reg Vardy established a business with firm foundations, and I am pleased to tell you that those foundations have supported the group's achievements in recent years. We have a great track record of profitable growth. In 1989, we became a public limited company, or PLC as it is known. The company was already successful, and there were fantastic opportunities to build on that success. However, to expand, the company needed access to more funds than profits alone could supply. Large financial institutions, pension funds, and a whole range of other organisations invested in the company, as did local people and many of our colleagues at the time. The shares were launched at 90 pence. They have grown in value since then. When shareholders invest in us, what do we invest the money in? Well, there are the premises, buying new dealerships, there are the people to operate them, and the training and development for all those colleagues. There is the stock, which is worth around 1 million to 1.5 million per dealership, and there are all the systems. We have talked about excellence, and it also applies to the working environment. Equipment should be state-of-the-art, and this is reflected in our investment in IT. Our used car systems are a good example of IT in action, and this is an area where nobody does it better than Reg Vardy. We have 8 to 10,000 cars within the group, and the sales executive in any one of our dealerships can find out exactly what a customer wants, tap into the group stock system to find a car which matches the customer's requirements, and the car can be in transit very quickly. Another excellent example of our internal IT developments is Vardy Showroom, a revolutionary point-of-sale system for vehicle sales, linking sales executives to a single database of all the group's customers and vehicles sold. Vardy Showroom professionalises the sales process, reduces administration, and provides substantial management information to ensure we maximise our sales opportunities. I'm looking forward to a great future with this company, and I hope you are too.
We want to ensure that each of our 6,000 colleagues really enjoys coming to work, is motivated and enjoys the challenges we experience every day. We have a philosophy of working together, of helping each other so that we work as a team, because each and every one of us needs to be pulling in the same direction if we are to achieve our aims. If we have total colleague satisfaction, if our dealerships are vibrant and our people are enthusiastic, then achieving high levels of customer satisfaction should be automatic. Customer satisfaction is the lifeblood of any organisation like ours. It is simple to understand, and you need to think of it as a circle. If people are happy with the purchase of their car, then they will come back and get their car serviced with us. If they're happy with the service, they will come back and buy their next car from us. And just as importantly, if they are happy, they will tell their friends and relatives. And so the circle gets bigger. This circle depends on each and every one of us and can be broken at any time. I often say that unless you're enthusiastic and keen to come to work, then it might be better for everyone if you stayed at home. Because every one of us needs to have a passion to provide excellent service for every customer that visits our dealerships every day. Now, this applies to everyone in the company, not just customer-facing colleagues, because we're all part of the service organisation. We are now a service provider. So how do we ensure that this circle isn't broken?
Michael, you head up the customer satisfaction department at Reg Vardy. What would you say are the key ingredients for a great customer relationship?
I think there's two things. The first is trust, obviously. We spend a long time talking to customers, and we're talking about very, very large purchases. This is possibly the second largest purchase after their house. So making sure that there's trust between the sales executive and the customer, between the service advisor and the customer, is absolutely critical. But the second thing is reliability. Because time and time again, when we talk to customers, one of the things they say is they never see the same person twice. So we need to make sure that we have long-term career progression within the business, that people who join us stay with us, and then they can develop relationships with the customer that build that trust and ensure that we all have a great time.
Now, that sounds like common sense, so why do you think we need to talk about it in a video like this?
Well, I think the most important thing is this is a growing business. This is a business that's taken on new dealerships over the last couple of years at a quite astonishing rate. And of course, with new dealerships, they're not just bricks and mortar, they're people. And as we have new people coming into the business, whether they're replacing people who've been promoted, whether they've come in through acquisitions, the most important thing for them is to make them feel comfortable and settle straight away, give them the confidence themselves that they're going to have a long-term future with us, and then immediately they can start to build that trust and confidence with the people they deal with who walk through the doors every day to see them.
You know, as a customer, that is exactly what I have found at some car dealerships that I've visited. So what exactly is your vision for the future of Reg Vardy?
What we really want to see is
the garage becoming part of the community more than anything else. So when somebody in the local area is thinking about buying a new or a used car or having their car serviced, the first dealership they think about is Reg Vardy, because we're part of the local scene.
Now, of course, we all know that this is the real world and that things do sometimes go wrong. So what should your colleagues know about how to go about dealing with customers' queries and complaints?
Well, that's absolutely right. This is the real world and things do go wrong. You have to remember that what we put a car through is quite incredible. If you left a washing machine or a fridge freezer out in the open air, things would go wrong with it. Well, a car is going to go wrong. It will need maintaining, and they're expensive items. So if a customer comes into a dealership and they've got a comment or a query or a complaint, then we have to remember that there are people within the dealership who are charged with the responsibility and the authority to solve those problems. The sales manager, the service manager, and ultimately the general manager. We do have a customer services team at Houghton House, our support centre in Sunderland, and they're to offer sort of last chance advice. But we're not here at Houghton House to solve the problems. The best people to solve the problems are the people in the dealerships who have the cars, who have the skills, who have the expertise to be able to get people back on site.
Michael, thanks for talking to us today. I think we all agree that treating others the way we'd like to be treated ourselves is the key not only to customer satisfaction, but also to your job satisfaction.
Illustrate what I think will make us the UK's best motor retailer is to ensure that we have a purpose and a set of values that we all try to adhere to. We've printed these on this card so that we can all see what will make us the best in the industry. Do we need a card? Well, I'm trying to lead a team of 5,000 to 6,000 people in dealerships located all over the country, and I'm often asked what are the characteristics of a Reg Vardy person. So I've put them down here. Our purpose and the reason that we exist is to meet the needs and dreams of the motoring public. A short statement, but one that says an awful lot about the attitude that we need if we are to be the best. Meeting needs and dreams is something that applies to sales as well as after-sales customers. We need to give each and every one the sort of service that people only dream about. It needs to be an attitude of mind for all of us that we strive to achieve each day. So, as well as our purpose statement, on the other side of the card, we also have this set of Vardy values. This enables each and every one of our colleagues to understand their individual and team responsibilities and the environment that we all, as colleagues, should enjoy at work. Let me take you through these now. There are 7 of them, and I hope you can relate to each one of them and see what a fantastic company this will be if we can all live day by day with these values. Passion. When people try to describe a Vardy person, the first word they should always use is passion. We're proud of our company and dedicated to its purpose. We're enthusiastic, enjoy challenges, and are eager for success. Motor retailing is an exhilarating business, but it does have its share of challenges. It's a very narrow margin business, but in spite of that, we've succeeded over the years in building what the industry says is the most successful and profitable group in the UK. We want this success and growth to continue, and to do that, we need everyone to have the passion to make things happen. The second value is respect. We are friendly and courteous in all of our relationships with colleagues, customers, and suppliers. We talked earlier about colleague satisfaction so that we are happy in our working environment. We're in a retail environment, fast-moving and demanding, and our desire to perform should not crowd out our respect for one another. If we are able to respect one another, it will lead to a great dealership environment, which customers will instantly recognise and feel. We will then almost automatically have respect for each of our customers. We will understand what they're looking for, what they want, what they need, and why. The easy route is to pretend not to notice customers and their problems. We want to be seen as the people who go out of their way to make customers feel valued. We must also have respect for our suppliers. Whilst we will be astute and very commercial in our buying and want things for the best possible price, we must treat all our suppliers, whether it is vehicle manufacturers or the suppliers of our paper clips, with respect. Our third value is professionalism. We are reliable and consistent, and we excel in the standards of presentation of our people, products, and premises. We are seeking to offer the same high level of service throughout the whole of our dealer network. Whether a customer is visiting Aberdeen or Reading, the same level of professionalism should be displayed. As colleagues, we are the company's greatest assets, and our appearance, our attitude, and our good manners will convey professionalism to all who visit us. Our products, our cars, our parts display, our service reception area, our parts delivery vans, and even the cars we drive need to be presented to the highest standards. In terms of dealership premises, I know one or two dealerships are awaiting refurbishment or relocation, but for the most part, our premises are the best in the industry. They are in the right locations, on high-profile sites, and they need to be well maintained. Our next value is integrity. We are trustworthy and honest in all that we say and do, and take responsibility for our own actions. Sadly, our industry does not always have the highest reputation in terms of integrity and honesty. Customers sometimes feel that we will say anything to sell, so we must be aware of this and allay the fears of our customers at every opportunity. We must try to sell customers what they really want and to build up a rapport with each and every one of them so that they find us as individuals and as a company trustworthy and honest. We all know that cars sometimes develop faults, but we need to take responsibility when problems arise. It is far too easy to pass the buck from one department to another. We need to own the problem and resolve it for our customers first and foremost. Of all the values, this is the one which we must embrace with our hearts and minds if we are to be part of a world-class company. It may not change the public's perception of motor retailing in general, but it can change their perception of Reg Vardy. The next value is recognition. We appreciate the endeavours of our colleagues, we praise their achievements, and we enjoy celebrating their successes. Our company has been extremely successful over the last 20 years, and it has been a pleasure to recognise those who have performed above and beyond the call of duty. Many of the awards are high profile with big presentations, but equally effective is the recognition of colleagues within a dealership or a team for a job well done. It is amazing how much encouragement a colleague gets from hearing the words well done or even thank you. So please take time out to recognise those who make a difference and those that perform well in your own dealership. When was the last time you appreciated the efforts of one of your colleagues? Opportunities is our next value. We have a vision of what can be achieved and provide colleagues with personal development, supportive training, and exciting career progression. One of the company's strengths is that we can see what can be achieved. Some of the dealerships which we buy have not performed well in the past. By firing up the sales operations and improving after-sales performance, they have been turned into super dealerships. This has created many opportunities for the hundreds of people within the company. For those with great ambition, there is really no limit as to how far you can go in this company. A vast amount of investment goes into training, more perhaps than in any other company in our industry. We want to train and develop each and every one of our colleagues to achieve their full potential. Our final value is commitment. We are determined to achieve total customer satisfaction through our pursuit of excellence. Delivering customer satisfaction is the prime aim of the group. A business which needs to deliver new customers every day has no chance of growth. So we must ensure that we retain all of our customers so that they come back to us time and time again and that they recommend their friends to us. Only then will we have a sustainable business. I want Reg Vardy to be the company that everyone in the industry would choose to work for. The company that provides the sort of service that delights every single customer, no matter how difficult they are. I want Reg Vardy to be synonymous with service, the motor retailer that every customer would choose, and the one that they would all recommend to their friends. In all these values, you may have noticed that I have not mentioned profit once. And that is because I believe that if we get all these other things right, then profit will flow as a result. Putting profit first will destroy us as individuals and also us as a company. I hope and trust that this does not sound like the Ten Commandments, thou shalt do this and that, etc. It is a set of values that make common sense, and I think we will all benefit if we treat others as we would like to be treated ourselves. You heard earlier from Robert Forrester, our Managing Director, about the growth of the company and long-term vision. Robert and I, along with Jerry McAloon, our Finance Director, are the three Executive Directors on the PLC board. As a public company, we have lots of shareholders, and each year we report our results to the city. Our financial year ends at the end of April, so we go in July with our full year results, and then with our six-month results in either December or January. Robert, Jerry and I are supported by an operations board, which includes the regional directors running our dealership operations and a team of support directors who are responsible for sales, marketing, after sales, law, financial services, franchise development and contract motoring. Houghton House really is a support centre to each of our dealership operations. But what is really important is what actually happens in our dealerships on a day-by-day basis. Management teams directing our businesses right, offering very high levels of customer service, and obviously maximising sales and profitability. So we look forward to you joining and to you playing a major role in developing our business and offering outstanding customer satisfaction to everyone who walks through the door.
I'd like to tell you about my passion for cars. From a Formula Ford champion in 1975 to sitting on a Grand Prix grid in 1980 and standing on the podium at Le Mans in 1990, cars have been in my blood. And I'm really looking forward to seeing how Reg Vardy, one of the leading car retailers in Europe, operates. And to find out about Sir Peter Vardy's passion for profit.
Thank you for inviting me along today. So what do you see as the best opportunity to ensure the future success of Reg Vardy, Victoria, Rossley, Trust and Bushbury?
What we have to concentrate on is to maximise the profit potential from each of the dealerships that we've got, to take the dealerships on to the next level of growth. The greatest opportunity we've got is to harness the thoughts and minds and passion and determination of all 6,000 people. If I can persuade the 6,000 people to engage their minds and their brains in how we sort this business out, how we move forward, how we maximise profit, we need a passion for profit, and then we also need a war on waste. If we can do those two things together and work together as a team to achieve those ends, then the future will be guaranteed.
So what exactly is working together?
Well, there are six items really. It's a group of trained
and willing colleagues united around a challenging and common goal, structured to work together, sharing responsibility, relying on one another, and empowered to implement agreed decisions.
So it sounds like working together is good for everyone, but I understand with this new initiative there's a new bonus system.
If they get to 90% of the target, they'll get £20. If they hit the target, they'll get 40, and if they hit an optimistic target, they'll get £60. So on this basis, everyone can earn at the top level, and that's why we need everyone contributing to make sure that we hit those profit levels and hit the optimistic profit levels.
So what can the Reg Vardy people do to help themselves achieve these bonus targets?
Well, in the last Working Together initiative, we asked all the colleagues, if it was your business, would you do it like this? And it was very interesting to see some of the statements that came back. This time, though, we have a set of questions that we're going to put to each colleague. So, for example, for a technician, we would say, tomorrow morning you're going to be made service manager of this dealership. What would you do differently to help increase turnover, increase hours sold? And where do you see the waste in the operation that you could cut out to save money?
I would pre-pick more of the parts to save us travelling backwards and forwards to and from the parts counter. On average, during the day, we would probably walk between 15 and 20 times to the counter, and it's probably costing us somewhere in the region of 1 to 2 hours of time.
Just say we could half that. That's 1 hour for every technician that we could sell at the hourly rate across the group. Do you know how much money that amounts to? £14 million worth of labour sales. Now that's sales, that's selling the hour instead of standing around in the workshop.
But more importantly, how much could you increase his bonus by?
Well, he gets another hour's bonus, so that's more money for the technicians. So that's an area we need to sort out, isn't it? Nice to see you, Andy. Yeah. Thanks very much. Good to see you. Thanks.
Cheers.
So all of those questions are going to be asked right through the dealership, through every department, that these are the 8, 10, 12 initiatives that they're going to take forward that will drive profitability and therefore drive the bonuses to each colleague in the dealership.
Right, that makes a lot of sense, but you know, why do you want everyone involved? Isn't there a danger of too many cooks and all that?
Well, I keep saying to all our colleagues here, with each pair of hands comes a free brain. And if we ask the colleagues who are working in the service and parts departments, in the administration departments, in the accounts offices, if we ask them for their opinion, they will come forward with some very valuable ideas. They can see the waste. We only need to ask them to engage them in this quest for war on waste and a passion for profit, and we will be amazed at the good ideas that come out of this exercise.
But how much do you really think that this Working Together programme can achieve?
It can achieve phenomenal growth. We saw it the last time. Mike Clark here in the dealership in Darlington was making £300,000 a year. He ended up making £1.2 million. Similar experiences were seen in other dealerships. Every dealership that tried it saw phenomenal growth. It's evident that it can be done. We're in a narrow margin business, but by the way we do things, we make it even narrower. We can expand that margin by cutting the waste and having a passion for profit.
So you're convinced that this Working Together initiative is the way to go?
We need to do something different. I just need the support of every one of our 6,000 colleagues, and the year ahead is going to be exceptionally good.
Well, I have to say, I've really enjoyed coming here today to be part of a winning team. This Darlington multi-site has given me a real insight into the enthusiasm that surrounds Reg Vardy. There's a part for everyone to play. Take care, good luck, and enjoy working together. We'll be right back.
Fantastic performance for surprisingly little difference in fuel consumption. You'd be glad to know that the insurance for this is free for the first year. It's smaller than it looks. And we have her guarantee that the mileage is genuine.
I'd like you to meet Eric. Not a Reg Vardy sales executive, but not so very untypical of his profession. What he says might seem perfectly normal for someone keen to make a sale. In fact, he's way out of line, the line being the Trade Descriptions Act. In the way he handles these customers, Eric puts himself and his company at risk of prosecution a number of times. This situation where the customer defines his requirements may be rare, but what follows illustrates some very important legal issues.
Good morning. Looking for anything in particular?
Oh, we phoned earlier about this new Clio, the one advertised in last night's Chronicle.
Ah, yes, Mr. and Mrs. Roberts. I'm Eric Bailey. Now, as for the particular car you asked about...
It's for our son.
He's going to university.
And with a car, he can commute to the campus and travel home at weekends.
The thing is, the student house has only got a backyard, so it's a tight squeeze even for a small car.
And naturally, we're also looking for a low price, very low fuel consumption, and the lowest insurance class. So this should do nicely.
One slight problem. You see, this particular car is simply a display model and, well, all of those have been sold, I'm afraid. We actually only had a very limited number at that price.
So why didn't your advert say so?
Ah, the advert. Well, I didn't actually get to see the advert. But for the money we're talking about, a kneeling new McGann coupe would give you a lot more without having to pay any more. Come and have a look. Now, this is a good, sporty little number, perfect for a young lad.
Oh, I love the colour, and it's his 19th birthday coming up.
A fantastic performance for surprisingly little difference in fuel consumption.
But won't the insurance be...
I was just coming to the insurance. You'd be glad to know that the insurance for this is free for the first year. All part of the deal.
You'll make a big impact driving around the campus in this.
Yes, but it does seem a lot bigger than the one we'd originally intended.
Well, you'd be right to say seems bigger, but you should have no more problem than the Clio squeezing in that backyard. And it does offer a lot more space for the actual on-road footprint.
Which means?
It's smaller than it looks.
What about the mileage?
Oh, precisely 2,490.
Not bad at all. Assuming that's what it's really done.
We're a reputable dealership, Mr. Roberts. This car's had one lady owner, so I understand. And we have her guarantee that the mileage is genuine.
I'm a bit puzzled by the price. It isn't the same as the advertisement here.
Well, it is if you add £235 for metallic paint.
But you didn't.
Remember, though, you are getting free insurance as a very valuable part of the deal.
How much are we talking about, all told?
Well, I don't want there to be any misunderstanding, Mr. Roberts. If you take into account the very favourable finance package you're able to offer, long term, once your lad's finished his course...
What do you think?
I don't think we'll decide anything. Not until I've taken a test drive.
As if Eric hadn't caused enough problems, he continues to break the law and also seems happy to drive a car that is effectively uninsured. To give him credit, he does remove the price sticker to clear the driver's view. Note the enormous confidence Eric has in Mr. Roberts' driving ability, one that he's actually qualified to drive. and two, that he's so familiar with the controls of the Megane that he can happily drive off.
Happy with the seat in position?
Great.
Great, right, there's the keys. I'll be back in a jiffy.
Yes, thanks.
Eric does remember the trade plates, but not the correct place to put them. There should, of course, be one attached to the front and one at the extreme rear of the car. Otherwise, the vehicle is not legally entitled to be on the road and is therefore not covered by insurance.
Piece of cake, the Megane. Off we go then. No worries. If you can't find them, grind them.
Actually, I'm more used to driving an automatic. I prefer to do take over the controls for a bit.
That's all right. I'll take it for the first couple of miles. The Megane's actually quite an easy car to drive once you get used to it.
Yeah.
Off we go then.
First opportunity, Eric stops, leaves the keys in the ignition for the passenger to take over, and makes room for him by walking around the rear of the car. At the end of the test drive, the Roberts sensibly said they'd like to think about it. They parted on the best of terms. Eric, like you, prides himself on building up a good relationship, all of which would count for nothing if the next time he met the customers they were in the witness box. So, Eric was let off the hook. Or was he? No sale does not mean no liability. They could have been local authority trading standards officers. They can arrive unannounced, either identifying themselves or posing as customers. Part of their job is to protect consumers from buying anything which turns out to be different from its description. However, customers may leave the premises apparently satisfied, yet subsequently lodge a complaint with trading standards, which may ultimately result in prosecution. This can happen whether they've bought anything or not. The Trade Descriptions Act 1968 covers the following aspects of describing goods and services: fitness for purpose, other physical characteristics, testing and the results of testing, and other history, including previous ownership or use. What does that mean in terms of what you're selling? It applies to a Reg Vardy car when it's advertised, offered for sale, put on the forecourt, or anywhere in the dealership accessible to the public. It also applies to what you say. In fact, a court of law will generally decide that a verbal description overrides any description or disclaimer. For instance, about mileage. But you're only an employee of the company. Surely it couldn't be you that pays the penalty. Well, yes, it could be you. Criminal records have resulted from failure to check a car's history, which stated the odometer had been replaced. Under the law, the court can decide whether there is personal liability on behalf of the sales executive. The penalty for you can be as much as a £5,000 fine per offence and or 6 months imprisonment for each vehicle. On top of which, the company could be fined and suffer legal costs, lost time and lost reputation through bad PR, leading to lost customers and lost jobs. There's an awful lot at stake here. Let's look back and examine where Eric gets out of line. If customers arrived only to find that an advertised car was unavailable, what would you do?
We actually only had a very limited number at that price.
So why didn't your advert say so?
Legally speaking, Mr. Roberts was quite right. The advert could have been construed as misleading, as it did not refer to limited stock. So what should you do? If the last one hasn't actually been sold, even if it's a display model, you must be prepared to sell it. If a customer finds a car anywhere that he's entitled to go, it is deemed to be for sale and trading standards apply. If stocks have run out at your own dealership, you should try and source another through the Reg Vardy network. In the meantime, you should show them an alternative, provided it doesn't take you to the wrong side of the law, as it did with Eric.
A fantastic performance for surprisingly little difference in fuel consumption. It's smaller than it looks.
How does that match up to the customer's stated need for a low-cost, low fuel consumption, lowest insurance class car to be driven by a 19-year-old student, and, what's more, can be parked in a small backyard. Let me remind you, the Trade Descriptions Act covers fitness for purpose. Descriptions like surprisingly low and smaller than it looks could be construed as a misdescription, or they could be acceptable if you can substantiate them. Just be watchful about what you say.
You'll be glad to know that the insurance for this is free for the first year.
Not giving details of the insurance could have come back to haunt Eric at renewal time, when Mr. Roberts received a request for £1,000 plus premium. Remember, verbal statements, even a nod of the head, can override written ones. Let's re-examine what happened about that most sensitive subject of all, mileage.
This car's had one lady owner, so I understand, and we have her guarantee that the mileage is genuine.
An odometer reading is a trade description because it describes a characteristic of the car. Courts have found a dealership liable for a surprisingly small odometer error.
What about the mileage?
So, if it hasn't been checked or you don't know, be open about it. The law says you must be clear and unequivocal. You should say something like, no car retailer can guarantee mileages, so to protect our customers, we have a company policy that all vehicles we sell must have their mileage investigated. And until we get results, I must ask you to disregard the reading. Never guess. If in doubt, refer the customer to your manager. As soon as a used vehicle comes into the dealership, a disclaimer notice must be fixed over the odometer. It would typically say, the dealership has not yet been able to verify the accuracy of the reading or is still checking, so the buyer should disregard it. In which case, Eric would have been protected, provided he did not alter this by any statement or verbal implication. Reputable dealers like Reg Vardy will often display a certificate proving they are striving to maintain the highest standards in the sale of used vehicles. By the way, this principle applies not just to the sales pitch, but to advertising, order form, finance, document, invoice, delivery sheet, warranty, the whole paper trail. The odometer mileage reading must be exact and identical on every item. But all this cannot and must not be overridden by saying a different figure. The need for consistency applies to every other aspect of description: age, date of registration, make, model, accessories, features, ownership, and pricing.
I'm a bit puzzled by the price. It isn't the same as the one as the advertisement here.
It may be tempting to reduce the base price of the car if a customer takes out finance. Although finance can be a useful hook for selling a car, provided it is tailored to a customer's need, it is effectively illegal to link it with a base price reduction. But the price difference in Eric's case stemmed from another reason.
Well, it is if you add £235 for metallic paint.
The law is clear on this point too. The price must include all non-optional extras, and that would include VAT if applicable, for example, on a dealer-fitted accessory such as audio equipment. If it had been a new car, the price should have included delivery, since it's a non-optional extra. A misleading price indication is a criminal offence under the Consumer Protection Act 1987. And incidentally, if there does happen to be a discrepancy with an advertised price, which you can't explain, it could be a misprint. But if you're not certain, don't dig a hole for yourself. Get the guidance of your manager. Finally, in his effort to make the deal attractive, Eric gave a handwritten finance quotation. Because it was not on a statutory quotation form, it would have contravened the law. These forms would only be produced at the customer's formal request and sent the following day by post. The penalty for handing over any credit details other than the statutory form could result in the withdrawal of the company's consumer credit license. How long could a company stay in business dealing only in cash? Reg Vardy's policy is only to give finance quotations with the approval of your business manager on the legally correct format, which has all the wording to comply with the law. So where does that leave Eric? In spite of Eric's best efforts, the Roberts did not commit themselves to buying them again at the price he quoted. But Eric could still be in deep trouble. A number of criminal offences occurred at the time the vehicle was being offered for sale. If the customers had been trading standards officers, they could have taken him to court on a number of infringements. Because the customers were still thinking about it, Eric actually thought he's done a good job. You may have thought so too. But in the course of a sale, driven by enthusiasm, it's all too easy to go too far, like Eric. Maybe just that once, but that could be once too many as far as your job and the company reputation are concerned. So here are a few simple don'ts to remember. Don't try to explain a price discrepancy or non-availability of an advertised vehicle yourself. Don't personally warrant mileage. Don't make verbal statements which are guesswork. Don't put vehicles with no properly positioned and worded disclaimers in public access areas. Don't quote prices without including VAT and all non-optional extras. Don't increase the price of a car to overcome a financing issue such as negative equity. Don't give written finance quotations on anything but approved forms and never without the approval by your sales manager or business manager. Again, if in doubt about anything, refer to your sales manager or business manager. Of course, it couldn't happen if Eric was working at a Reg Vardy dealership, could it? He would have seen this training video, and the key moments would have gone something like this.
This was our last Clio at the advertised price, and I'm afraid it was sold yesterday. But I will see if we can get hold of another one similar to the one in the advert for you from another Reg Vardy branch.
What about that silver coupe? That's a similar price.
Certainly, let's go and take a look. This is a nearly new Megane, although it is a little bigger than the Clio.
What about insurance?
It is a higher insurance group, and it's a lot less economical to run.
And is this the full price?
That's the full price, including sunroof and metallic paint.
You'll certainly make an impact driving on the campus in this.
There's no doubt about it, it's a better car, but it'll cost a lot more to run than the Clio, and I doubt that you'll get it under that backyard.
Is it low mileage?
Well, no car retailer can guarantee mileages, Mr. Roberts. So we have a company policy that all the cars that we sell must have their mileages investigated. And until we receive the results, I'm afraid I must ask you to disregard any of the readings. I'm pleased to tell you that my manager's confirmed that we do have a similar Clio in the same colour at another Reg Vardy branch.
Is it the same price as advertised?
That's the full price, including delivery.
When it comes to the test drive, as a Reg Vardy sales executive, Eric would have done everything by the book. He would have asked if the customer was qualified to drive. He doesn't have to produce the licence. As long as he says he's legally entitled, you are covered in the event of an accident. Obviously, this could be hard to prove after an accident, for example. So, where possible, you should ask to see the licence, read and photocopy it. For all customers who appear to be around 17 or 18 years of age, you should insist on the original driving licence. Putting trade plates anywhere but the correct position for a number plate invites prosecution. But no risk here. For the first leg of the test drive, the sales executive must take the wheel. Then, at a pre-planned safe point, you can stop to swap seats. Watch. An experienced sales executive will knock the mirror out of alignment and slide the seat back. Then he'll walk around the front of the car, taking the keys with him. Otherwise, he could find himself left standing there. The company has lost over 20 vehicles stolen during test drives in the last 10 years. Meanwhile, the driver has to adjust the seat or mirror to a comfortable, safe position. Now it's time to show the customer the important controls, especially if it's an automatic and the customer is used to a manual, or vice versa.
As you may notice that the indicators are actually on the left-hand side.
Yeah.
It's just common with the Renaults. And you'll find that the reverse is actually on the far left as opposed to the far right.
Okay.
The car's actually power steering, so you'll find it very light to drive, very sensitive.
Yeah.
So you might want to be aware of that.
Yeah.
There you go.
And that's how a risk-free textbook test drive begins. It's common sense, really. And it's also common sense to keep on the right side of the Trade Descriptions Act. Not only will you then stay on the right side of the law, but of your customers too. That's what people should come to expect when visiting the UK's top motor retailer, Reg Vardy. You don't have to be a legal expert, just follow the golden rule. Be sure what you're saying describes what you're selling, and if in doubt, check it out.
If you began by wondering why it was necessary to make a video programme about the legal pitfalls involved in selling cars, I hope it's clear now. There's a lot to remember, but it's vital that you do. Because there's a lot at stake in terms of your reputation and that of Reg Vardy PLC. Mr. and Mrs. Roberts are delighted with the car and a sale is confirmed. Now let's just take a moment to look at a very important aspect of the sale, cleared funds.
Now, you said that you wanted to finance part of the balance due on the car and pay the remainder with money you have in your bank account?
In order for them to take delivery of the car, Reg Vardy will first need approval from the finance company and payment from the customer. The finance company will require them to fill out and sign this proposal form, and upon acceptance, they will require us to take a copy of the customer's driving licence or proofs of identification, address and maybe income.
Yes.
Okay. How would you like to pay the remainder?
We were planning on writing a cheque.
Well, there are other options. A personal cheque is one. A banker's draft is another. A building society cheque. A debit card payment such as Switch. Or CHAPS electronic transfer.
I didn't realise there were so many ways for paying for a car.
Well, as you finance the car and the deposit is less than £5,000, we should be able to process the cheque in a matter of minutes using the Transact system.
The Reg Vardy policy requires us to approve all cheques less than £5,000 using Transacts. However, if the customers were to pay by cheque over £5,000, we would have to wait for the bank to clear it, which can take up to a full week.
Which is the quickest and cheapest method?
Well, it used to be bankers' drafts and building society cheques, but these days there are many problems with forgeries and stolen cheques and drafts.
There is a lengthy authorisation process before the car can be released. The easiest way is to use a Switch card or another debit card. The process takes about 40 minutes, but this can be done when the customer collects the car. Where the balance to pay is bigger than the average transaction, the customer's bank may want to speak to them before they approve the transaction. This is just to protect the customer and their bank.
Another method is CHAPS electronic transfer, but the bank will charge you a small fee for this. And remember, there is always good old-fashioned cash.
CHAPS and debit card are the group's preferred methods, being the fastest and most secure way to clear funds, which allows the customer to take their vehicle with minimum delay.
So does that mean we can take the car today?
It could well do. Once we receive the insurance cover note, we can tax the car for you.
Remember also that the insurance certificate or cover note must be an original document. It is against the law for us to accept a fax or photocopy.
More satisfied customers leave a Reg Vardy dealership. I have no doubt that they will return to have their car serviced and also tell their friends about the good deal and good customer service that they received from Reg Vardy. Now, there are many other issues facing our sales teams. With a great marketing campaign and strong advertising, we bring lots of customers through our doors. However, many of these customers are suffering from high levels of negative equity, brought about by the recent fall in used car values. We have a very good solution for many customers and a policy to deal with this problem, so that needs to be used. We won't be able to deal with all of these customers, and in some instances the best advice is to encourage the customer to keep their car a little longer. Perhaps not what you'd normally say, but it is the right advice to give. So remember the Reg Vardy values of professionalism and integrity. We must build our reputation on being trustworthy, honest, and be responsible for our own actions. We are all determined to achieve total customer delight through our pursuit of excellence. Well, as the cartoon says, that's all, folks. So thanks for watching this DVD. It has been rather long, if you've watched it all, but we really feel it's important to understand as much about the company as possible before you join. So as you prepare to come to us, we hope that you're really looking forward to it, and we welcome you to Reg Vardy and to a long and happy career with our company. So all the very best.